Thank you very much. I hope the mic is on. Okay, I think we are. Well, let's begin. I'm Juliana, and this is Susan. Thank you so much for coming all the way from Shenzhen to join us. The format is we will have a chat for about an hour, then I will open it up to all of you. And I think it'll be a very interesting 90 minutes. Quick show of hands, has anyone already read Susan's third novel? Okay. Well, let's, if we can, may I ask if we can try not to spoil the ending or give out too many spoilers, perhaps in the question and answer, or the question in this case, that will follow our sharing session, because, you know, I do hope everyone comes and picks up a coffee afterward. Now, let me give a quick introduction of Susan. She grew up in East London. She studied philosophy at the University of Leeds and creative writing at the University of Manchester. Now, she's the author of three novels. This one, The Incarnations, is the third. The first was set in Japan, called Sayonara Bar. It was published almost 10 years ago. So you started writing very early on. And the second was called The Orientalist and the Ghost, published 3 years after that. That was set in Malaysia. And Susan will talk about why you chose to explore, in some ways, a very personal story in your second novel. Both were longlisted for the Dylan Thomas Prize. Now, her current novel, that's the novel that we are talking about today, is called The Incarnations. It's about a taxi driver in contemporary Beijing, or I should say, not exactly contemporary, because it was, what, 6 years ago. So in China time, that was a long, long time in the past. But still considered modern China. Driver Wang is his name. Now, his story in modern Beijing is interwoven with tales from the Tang Dynasty, the invasion of Genghis Khan, the Ming Dynasty, the Opium War, and the Cultural Revolution. So it really spans a really long period in Chinese history, but of course, by no means the entire span of Chinese ancient history. Now, while writing The Incarnation, she spent several years living in Beijing, researching modern and imperial China. Now, we'll be talking about your research, because you did quite a lot of research. And you spent a lot of time in Beijing as well. And actually, I've lived in Beijing myself, and I recognize the areas that you talk about. In fact, I used to work in that area. So very interesting. Let's talk about your research as well. Now, she's received many grants to fund her various writing projects, including from the Arts Council of England, Society of Authors. She's also been an artist in residence at the Corporation of Yado. And several other areas, including in Beijing. Now, Susan, let's back up a bit. I'm always so interested in why people choose to write and why people choose to become a novelist specifically. What inspired you to write novels and to write about Asia?
It's quite a long story, if that's okay. Firstly, thank you all for coming. Thanks so much. It's great to see you all here. Right, so how did I become a writer? Okay, I don't come from a very literary family. I didn't read books very much as a child. You hear stories about writers who read really voraciously as they were growing up. I wasn't like that at all. When I was at school, in fact, I was really interested in science, and I wanted to, I did science A-levels, and I wanted to be a chemistry teacher. That was my ambition at school. And I started a degree in chemistry at Nottingham, and dropped out after a semester because I realized I didn't have the passion and enthusiasm to sustain myself for the duration of the degree. So I left chemistry and I changed to philosophy. And while I was studying philosophy, I obviously got used to writing long, discursive academic essays. And I wrote for the student paper. I was an arts editor. And then I wanted to be a journalist. And I did work experience at the Times. And I applied for other internships. But it was quite hard to find a good job in journalism just after I graduated. So I ended up teaching English in Japan for 2 years. And it was in Japan where I started to write fiction. I was in a small town called Nagaokakyo outside Kyoto, and it was a really strange and new experience for me because I was one of only four foreigners in the town, and we were very conspicuous. On our first day in the town, we were taken to meet the mayor at the town hall, and the local press was there, and our picture was taken, and we're in the paper, and everyone in the town knew who I was. If I cycled about, people would call out my name. So I felt very conspicuous, but at the same time, very isolated because I didn't speak much Japanese, and I was working in this middle school where not many teachers could speak Japanese. So I was in this bubble of incomprehension for most of my working day. And I started to keep a journal while living in Japan, just to, I guess, describe everything to myself because everything was new and I hadn't experienced it before. Just to also to have a conversation with myself because there weren't many other English speakers in the town. And I kept the journal for about a year. And what I started to do as I wrote in the journal was I started to write scenes of my daily life. I'd write a scene I saw in the staff room or in the classroom, and I would write descriptive narrative and dialogue. And I realized I was fictionalizing things that happened in my day. And that sort of gave me the confidence to write actual fiction. So, yeah, I started writing short stories in Japan, and that was my sort of way in.
So it was almost a circuitous route. You didn't have a grand plan of becoming the next great novelist.
No, not at all. I started reading fiction as well in Japan as well. As I said, I didn't read much as a child and a teenager. There was a girl in the next town, and she owned the Japan Exchange teaching, that was the scheme I was on. She owns the library for the Kyoto area, all the English language books. And she was moving back to the States, and she had hundreds of books in her room. And she said, does anyone want them or want to take over the library? And I volunteered. So I inherited all of these books in my second year in Japan and just started reading my way through them. So yeah, I started reading fiction and writing it in Japan as well. And I didn't have big plans to be a writer. I initially really wanted to be a journalist, and perhaps I would have done if I had found an internship or a job before going to Japan. I wouldn't have gone to Japan, I guess.
Was there something about being in a very different kind of culture, a culture that was very different to you? Mm-hmm. Do you think that was instrumental in pushing you to write narrative?
It's hard, yeah, it's really hard to say. I think when you're living in another country and you feel like an outsider, as I said, I felt very conspicuous in living in this small town in Kyoto. I didn't fit in. People were pointing out my difference to me all the time. I think when you're in that situation, you do become more of an observer, and observation skills or just noticing details and noticing difference is very good when you're writing fiction, I think. Yes, it helped in that respect. I can't say if it was really instrumental to me becoming a writer.
So that novel was published in 2005.
Yes.
And then soon after, only 3 years later, you published your second novel. That was set in Malaysia, so that's closer to home,
right?
Because part of your family is Malaysian Chinese. Tell me how you chose that setting and those stories.
Right. Well, I wanted to write a novel about Malaysia, I think, to teach myself about Malaysian culture and history. I really believe in writing about what you want to deepen. I think writing fiction is a way we deepen our knowledge about the world, and I really wanted to research and learn more about Chinese history. The novel, The Orientalist and the Ghost, it starts in the 1950s, and it's set during the communist insurrection, which lasted from 48 to, I believe it was the early 60s, I can't quite remember. But there were lots of terrorist attacks going on in Malaysia around that time. And my inspiration was, my family used to talk quite a bit about the insurrection, and they'd tell me stories when I was a kid about communist guerrillas hiding out in the jungle and the Batu Caves, and there was a curfew in their town, and sirens would go off, and they'd all have to be at home at a certain hour. This was in the 50s. So that sort of, when you hear stories like this as a child, it made me curious and want to learn more about it, which I couldn't from my family because they're not very political, and they only have anecdotes like this rather than a deep sort of political awareness of what was going on at that time. So that was the inspiration for the communist aspect of the story. And then the novel goes forward to the late 60s, to the race riots that occurred after the 68 election. And that was inspired by my family talking about the violence between the Malays and the Chinese that occurred in the aftermath of the election, and the kind of resentment that's always been there towards the Malay since those riots, because they weren't properly resolved and there was no reparations for what happened, and a lot of the media wasn't very honest at that time as well. So yeah, that was the inspiration for write the second book.
How did you get from colonial or post-colonial Malaysia to contemporary and ancient Beijing and China?
Right, okay. When I was researching the second novel, I was researching the Communist Party in Malaysia, and the Communist Party in Malaysia in the 50s was sponsored and had quite close connections to the party on the mainland. And so my research took me from Malaysia to mainland China and the history of the Communist Party there, Mao Zedong, 20th century history in China, which is very tumultuous. It's full of war and revolution and you know, big major upheavals. It's astonishing, actually. And as soon as I finished the second novel, The Orientalist and the Ghost, and submitted the manuscript, my curiosity had been piqued about Chinese 20th century history, so I went back to researching that, and then I started to read about Imperial China all the way from the Qin Dynasty, the First Dynasty, all the way to the Qing Dynasty, and there's a lot going on in those 2,000 years, and yeah, loads of stuff started inspiring me, and I thought I'd really like to write a book set in contemporary Beijing, but with these historical stories interwoven into the narrative.
And so you moved to Beijing. When was that exactly?
The summer of 2007. Yeah.
And did you speak any Chinese at the time?
I spoke very, very basic, broken Chinese at the time. It was tough. Yeah.
we'll get to that in a second. Yeah. But let's have a sense of your novel. Are you able to read us a short excerpt? A small overview without giving much away, because it is quite a suspenseful narrative.
Okay, so I'm just going to read a couple of pages from the second chapter of the novel. This introduces the main character. He's a taxi driver called Wang Jun, and this will give you a snapshot of his day-to-day life before he receives this letter that changes his life forever. So chapter 2, Wang Jun. Through the windscreen of his taxi, Wang has seen the city change. He has seen wrecking balls swing, bulldozers leveling streets to rubble and dust, and skyscrapers rising like bamboo after the rain. In the decade Wang has been a taxi driver, Beijing has changed radically. And as the dust of construction gusts across the city, sheet after sheet, he often wonders when it will end. Pedestrians wave him down, and Wang drives them all over Beijing. He is mostly silent throughout his 12-hour shift, and most passengers behave as though he's not there, or as though he's a mechanical part of the car, like the gear stick or steering wheel. They don't censor what they say in the back seat, and some of the conversations lure Wang's attention in. Investment bankers bragging of profits of millions of yuan, a junior high school student with metal braces on her teeth describing how she lost her virginity to a sorcery-eyed friend, scientists from the Institute of Meteorological Sciences debating the ethics of cloud seeding, the Weather Modification Office's strategy of firing silver iodide into the clouds to wring out some rain. Man must defeat the heavens, the woman scientist insisted, quoting Mao. Money is what his passengers talk of most. How much per square meter? How much for the upgrade? How much do you earn? How much? Beijing is richer now than when Wang first started out as a driver, and his fares click compulsively at shiny metallic laptops and fidget with the latest gadgets in the back. They're shallow, materialistic, and vain. But Wang would like to be wealthy too, to own a modern high-rise two-bedroom apartment, to send his daughter Echo to private school and have braces put on her teeth. Confident that Wang is no one of importance, passengers rarely exercise caution in his cab. Wang has been privy to the offering of bribes to men in suits, to the haggling down of the price of women bought and sold in bulk, to the trading of forged passports and negotiation of human smuggling fees. Once, a guy in his 20s hired Wang out for an afternoon. When it became apparent, as they drove from address to address, that he was dealing drugs, Wang asked what he was selling. Cocaine, the dealer had said. Aren't you afraid of the death penalty? Wang asked, and the dealer had laughed. When it comes to the police, there are ways of getting off the hook. Lovers quarrel in his taxi. They fight about sex and abortion and extramarital affairs. Sometimes they remember he is there. Shh, the driver. Fuck the driver. What does what he think matter? And they go on with their row. Wang knows how manipulative the lovesick can be, the recklessness of those afflicted with the mental illness of romantic love. Wang's backseat has known more melodrama than any far-fetched TV soap. Sometimes late at night, when passengers are drunk and lonely and heading home to an empty bed, they unburden themselves to Wang, pouring out their unhappy personal lives to this safe, anonymous taxi driver. They ask his advice. Sometimes they ask for more than his advice. One woman in her 30s, whose boss had recently ended their affair, had said casually to Wang, "Can you take me somewhere? I need cheering up." When Wang had protested that he had a wife and child, she had laughed and said, "That's never stopped any man I've ever known." The woman was plain-looking, but fiery and bold, and Wang could see what had attracted her boss. He imagined driving her to an empty car park, but he couldn't do it. The woman stared out at the drizzly night streets of Beijing as he drove her the rest of the way home, not saying a word. Wang offered to waive her fare, but she made a point of paying him in full.
Very evocative. As a former Beijing resident, I really felt that you capture so many details that one would only be able to capture if you actually lived there for a period of time. I think I remember you also wrote about the smells in a Beijing taxi. And for those of you who've visited Beijing in winter especially, you know what I'm talking about, the kind of mix of body odor and garlic. You know, it was so evocative to me. Clearly you thought it was important to live there. Mm-hmm. What was that like? Was it scary moving to Beijing without knowing anyone?
Yes, slightly scary, but not to the extent that it put me off. I moved there in the summer of 2007, and my strategy was just, my main ambition was to write a novel set in Beijing. I didn't have a plan of what I was going to write. I knew I wanted to write about urban China, interspersed that with some historical stories, and I just moved to Beijing, started living day-to-day life in the city, experiencing daily life, observing, exploring, and I really waited to see how what I experienced would shape the narrative of the book. Yeah, that was my approach. For the historical stories, obviously my research is more text-based, but for the contemporary section, yeah, I just spent a year or two living in Beijing and learning about the city.
Yeah. You were teaching English also at the time?
No, actually, I was writing full-time. I had two small English teaching jobs. I taught at the Ministry of Health on Saturdays, a class in conversational Chinese. So that was great because their English was very high level. And I got to, you know, talk to them about contemporary China and politics and ask their opinions and set up debates. That was a really interesting teaching gig. And I taught as a volunteer for a few weeks at a mental hospital in Chaoyang. Yeah.
And there is a mental hospital in the novel.
That's right, yeah. That's right.
Was that based on first-hand experience?
Very much so. The atmosphere of the mental hospital and the lives of the inpatients was directly taken from what I experienced in the Beijing hospital where I taught, yeah.
Was Beijing what you expected? Did the narrative change over the time that you were there?
Well, I had no narrative when I first arrived. The narrative was really shaped by the book, by my circumstances. I first decided...
You weren't a taxi driver.
Sorry, I wasn't a taxi driver. No. I first decided to make my main character a taxi driver in December of 2007. I was walking about in Dongcheng District near the Drum Tower, and I saw, it was a winter's day, very cold, and I saw three taxis parked in a row, and the taxi drivers were having a cigarette break and smoking and chatting to each other. And I went over and I just started chatting to them and practicing my Chinese. We didn't talk about anything especially deep and meaningful. We're just comparing cigarette brands. And
That's pretty meaningful.
Yeah. Yeah, they're unimpressed with my Marlboro Light. But yeah, as I continued walking, I said goodbye to them, continued walking, something sort of clicked in my head, and I thought about how taxi drivers drive to every different district of the city. They have passengers from many different walks of life. And in the book I was trying to write about Beijing, I really wanted the city to have a very central presence. I wanted the traffic and the concrete and architecture and people to have a stronger presence as a central character. And I thought that by having a taxi driver as the protagonist and showing the reader Beijing as seen for a taxi driver's windscreen as he goes about his working day would offer the reader a panoramic view of the city. So having a taxi driver as a protagonist, I was able to write about urban China in a really sort of diverse way.
Well, the novel has been extremely well reviewed. It's been described by the Pulitzer Prize winning author Adam Johnson as the most extraordinary work of imagination you'd read all year. And I have read it, and I think it's really an extraordinary work. How did then the narrative progress? So you had in your mind the central character, the taxi driver. What about the love story or the central relationship, I should say, at the center of it? How did you come to decide you wanted a relationship like that?
You mean the relationship between the letter writer or
yes, Zhang Yan? The letter writer.
The person sending the anonymous letters.
Yes. For me, that was the narrative structure that carried me through.
Right,
you know, because
okay.
I wanted to find out who it was.
Right, I see. Yeah, yeah. Well, the way I wrote this book was very strange, actually, because I basically started researching what I was interested in, and then I researched urban China and several different historical eras, and I researched them and started writing fiction stories set in each historical era of modern China, and then afterwards I thought about how am I going to structure this as a novel, and that's where the letter writer comes in. But with the historical stories, So I knew I wanted to write about urban China. With the historical stories, I just read books that gave a broad overview of Chinese history. And when I was interested by a specific era or incident or historical figure, I would deepen my research into that area and do more research. And ideas for stories and characters would surface from that research. So that was how I chose the different historical eras. And the contemporary narrative, of course, because I was living in Beijing in 2007, 2008, so it seemed convenient to set it then. But the theme of reincarnation and anonymous letters and epistolary historical storytelling, this sort of came after I started writing the book and doing the research. And it was initially a narrative device to structure the novel, to bring all of my separate research interests together. But with each redrafting of the book, so I redrafted it several times over the 6 years I was writing the book, the reincarnation aspect became more significant and more spiritual and more sort of the essence of the book, because it's all about how human history is cyclical, human nature is cyclical, history repeats itself, and reincarnation seemed very apt.
And that's actually a very Chinese view of history, right, as well as power. You know, power waxes and wanes, and you have cycles.
Yeah.
I mean, was all that known to you before you started working in China? Because I don't get the sense that you were a so-called China person,
right,
before you started your research.
Right. Did I understand the Chinese conception that history is cyclical and...
Or perhaps you understood it, but it wasn't... I guess I'm asking, were you kind of a China person before you moved to China? Or did you make that decision based on the research for your second book and decided, oh, I think that would be my third novel?
I guess I was a Malaysian Chinese person rather than a mainland Chinese person.
Because they're very different.
Culturally, there's a lot of difference, politically, obviously, as well. My interest always gravitated towards the Chinese in Malaysia. Mm. And it was through my second book that I became interested in mainland China.
Was it what you expected? Was it, I mean, how much culture shock did you experience? Because Malaysia and China are very different.
Yeah, they are, yeah. I don't know about culture shock. I found Beijing, in some respects, is a very hard city to live in. You've lived there before.
It was easier before.
Actually, when I was there in 2007, it's easier then comparatively to how it is now. I think the pollution's got worse and the streets are more gridlocked. There's more cars on the road. It's harder to get about. The population's increasing. There's more and more migrant workers and wealth disparity. It's a tough city to live in. So it wasn't so much culture shocked because I'd lived in Asia before and I've traveled a bit, I was kind of shocked. It's quite a hard city to live in.
What about the reaction to you as a person, not just as a writer, but as a person? Because Malaysia is a very multicultural society, mm-hmm. and there are lots of Eurasians. Mm-hmm. But in Beijing, not really. Did people see you as Chinese at all?
I think people see me as a Westerner in Beijing. They don't really see me as Chinese. But I think Beijing's quite an international city. People don't stare at me or anything like that. That was a small town in Japan. I encountered that sort of attitude.
Because we're talking about writing between the East and the West. Mm-hmm. And to me, this novel, in terms of the content, the characters, the history, is very Eastern. It's obviously
right.
Very much about China. What do you think you brought as a Western writer that perhaps a Chinese writer would have done in a different way?
That's very hard for me to say. There is this attitude in China, this opinion that the Chinese are a very different mindset from people from outside China. In particular, Westerners, they have a unique mindset that's ungraspable by people outside China. I think that's a very politically convenient attitude to have.
It's also often said in a very condescending way. I've always found.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
It's politically convenient if you're of a unique mindset that you can have a unique style of government offered by the Communist Party and their authoritarianism. But I actually disagree with the idea that there is an innate difference between people in China and people in the West. I think I've lived in the States, I've lived in Korea, Japan, and Malaysia. I've spent some time there. And I think people are the same everywhere. Fundamentally, we're all the same. We have the same desires and motivations in life. You want the same things, pretty much. We want love, status, recognition. What differs from culture to culture is how do we express love and what confers status and recognition upon people. So there are differences, of course, between my main characters are working class Chinese taxi drivers. There's a world of difference between me and him. But they're surface differences. They're cultural and social differences on the surface. Underneath, fundamentally, I think people are the same. But yes, I did have to reorientate my mindset somewhat to that of my Chinese characters, in particular the taxi driver. I had to think of how his political beliefs might differ from mine. He went through a different education system. He's in a country of quite an authoritarian government, so certain aspects of his life will be more regulated than mine. He's going to have different political beliefs. He's going to be relatively disenfranchised. He's an atheist, which is quite typical of people in China. But as well as the differences on an ideological level, I had to pay attention to the differences in his behavior and habits as well.
How did you do that kind of research? Was it watching taxi drivers? Did you spend a lot of time in the backs of taxis?
Right, I spent a lot of time in the front of taxis, sitting in the passenger seat and just talking the ears off taxi drivers.
It's usually the other way around.
I'm nosy as hell. I ask so many questions, sit in the front, practice my Chinese, loads of... I've been living in China on and off for 4 or 5 years, and that's always what I've done. And I did start off, when I first started writing this book, I wrote a questionnaire with about 20 questions. How long have you been a taxi driver? What do you think of the recent changes in the Olympics? And what changes in the last 10 years in Beijing do you like, dislike? But it was so formal and regulated, and it didn't feel organic, and the answers were quite stilted. So I thought the best way was just to sit in the front of a cab and just talk for long journeys.
What was their reaction to you? Did they know that you were working on a novel?
Yeah, I did. I laughed their heads off when I told them I was writing about a Beijing taxi driver. Like, good luck. The reaction to me was, I mean, they're very curious. I was curious about them. They're very curious about me as well. They usually would ask to say, oh, you're from England, eh? Yeah, it's a very wealthy country. And they'd ask me about the standard of living in England and houses expense, you know, just the kind of comparing and contrast economic and politics, I guess. They also asked me personal questions. Are you married? Do you have children? You're not married. Oh dear. And they, it's interesting. That's how I researched, I guess.
Do you think novelists should be researching in that way? Do you think novelists should be living in the places that they write about if it's not their home?
I think it really depends on the novelist. I think ultimately what validates a work of fiction is what legitimizes and validates it is the strength of the writing on the page, not the identity of the author or their life experience. There's an author in London, her name's Steph Penny, and she wrote a book called The Tenderness of Wolves, and it's set in the Canadian wilderness, and I think she won a big book award in the UK for this book, but she'd never actually travelled to the Canadian wilderness. She was agoraphobic, and she could barely travel to the British Library where she did her research. So she'd written this highly convincing book, emotionally compelling, but she'd never left London. I think it really depends. Me personally, I couldn't have written this book without spending time in Beijing. For me, that was essential. I couldn't have. It would be a very, very different book. But I think it really depends on the writer and their inclinations and their abilities as a writer.
Now, the modern part of the driver's life is set in Eastern Beijing. Mm-hmm. Not terribly fashionable part of Eastern Beijing. I lived there as well.
It's becoming
very expensive now. But why did you choose that location? Was it because you also spent time there?
Mizedien. Yeah. I lived in Mizedien for about a year or so. It was the second place I lived in Beijing, and it's in the east of the city, and it's very close to the Ministry of Agriculture, and I lived in a housing compound that used to be the dormitories for Ministry of Agriculture workers, more so during the 80s and 90s, but when I was there, a significant proportion of MOA employees were there, and I hung out with them, I was friends with them, and talked to them about working at the MOA and their lives, and that really shaped the narrative of the book, just the fact that I moved to Mizedien and hung out with these people, because that became my taxi driver's backstory. His parents worked at the Ministry of Agriculture, and I also did a homestay with a couple that worked there, and they influenced a couple of the main characters as well, the parents of the stepmother and father. So
did you think the writing, the entire process would take 6 years? Was that planned? No.
It was
because it's by no means long.
I'm a slow writer, I guess. It took a lot of drafts to get right. I mean, perhaps the reason it took so long was I was learning about China as I was writing about China. As I said, I moved to China 2007, minimal Chinese, didn't know very much. I don't have a China background, as you say. I was learning about China as I was writing about it. So what happened was I wrote a draft in a year and a half and threw it out entirely and wrote another draft to accommodate the new insights and knowledge I'd gained about China.
Was that painful?
It was painful, draft. But very necessary, I think, okay. Yeah.
Had it gone in a very different way?
I think the first draft, the characters were not three-dimensional enough. They weren't real enough. They were too... the characterization was too weak, so I had to throw it out and start again.
And that was based on your interactions with people and growing knowledge of the city?
Yeah, I guess so, yeah. And also the historical research was quite tough as well. Mm. I deviate quite a bit from historical fact in the book, I think, as a fiction writer, that's okay. But for each historical section, that was a couple of months in the library reading his history books and doing that kind of research.
In a library in China?
I lived, while writing this book, I lived in the UK, the States, and Korea, Beijing, so libraries in all those places.
Wherever.
Yeah.
Why was the lifestyle, why was your lifestyle so itinerant at that time?
Just my circumstances. I tried to stay, I moved to Beijing in 2007, lived there for a year, tried to stay during the Olympics, but they really tightened up their visa regulations, so I had to go and live in Korea for a couple of months. And then I was broke, and a friend had a house in Colorado and said, would you like to house sit for a few months? And I thought, that sounds great. I'll just go there and write, live in the middle of nowhere. And I did that. And then I ended up moving to Boston to house sit there, back to China. I had a job in Leeds. And yeah, so I've been all over the place. Yeah, I guess because I'm a writer, I don't have a 9-to-5 job. And so I have the freedom to move about. And also I'm able to live quite frugally. I can get by on very little money. Yeah.
Is that important?
Sorry?
Do you think, is that important?
Yeah, I think it is. If you want to write fiction, it's important, yeah.
Where was the bulk of the writing done? Was it in all these places?
All of these places. I got a fantastic amount of writing done in... I just lived in Shenzhen for a year and a half. My boyfriend works for Huawei, or did work for Huawei, in the northern industrial suburbs of Shenzhen. So we were really... Shenzhen's a very quiet city anyway. Not quiet culturally, rather than quiet economically. But we lived in the northern suburbs. There's nothing to do there at all. So really, just for a year and a half, got my head down and wrote. And that was like the last stretch of writing the novel as well. So it's more intense and focused. But yeah, I got a lot of writing done there.
What about the editing process? Do you edit as you write, or do you edit at the end?
I'm constantly redrafting. I think Zadie Smith wrote an essay in which she said there are two kinds of writers. There are architects and micromanagers. And the micromanager, I hope I'm getting this right, they write very, very slowly. They'll write a sentence over and over till it's perfect, then move on to the next sentence. And they'll write the book all the way through like this. And it's all a perfect first draft. And they'll get to the end. They'll write the end of the book.
And they don't go back.
And they don't go back. Okay. Maybe if their editor at the publishing house tells them to, they will, but they generally don't. Whereas I'm an architect, I have a plan of a novel, and I make a structure, perhaps, and I work on one part of the novel one day and another part the other day, throw stuff out, redraft. It's a big old mess, but I have a plan in my head, a very sketchy sort of layout of what the novel's going to be, and that's my approach to writing, and it's much more chaotic than being the micromanager sort of writer.
But without spoiling the ending, was that the ending you had in mind? Was that always constant?
I'd been writing the book for more than two years when I came up with that ending. I didn't know what the ending was. I tend to throw my characters into situations, sometimes dangerous situations, or then figure out how to resolve things afterwards. Yeah.
So you're not a J.K. Rowling. I think she actually you know, I guess it's different, obviously mm-hmm. different kinds of writing, but I read that she actually, on index cards, she had everything plotted out.
Right.
You know, many books in advance.
Wow.
And given how complex her books are, narrative, yeah. I mean, you just think, wow, you know, she knew.
Right.
You know, five books in advance what was going to happen.
Right.
I just thought that was amazing. But
yeah. I'm changing things as well. I'm always changing what's going to happen to a character, like, oh, I'll kill a character off and then bring them back to life in an earlier chapter. And yeah, but having a big old messy plan gives you the freedom to do that, I think.
Now, the book is just recently come out, but I'm wondering if there's been a difference in reaction between readers, obviously they're reading in English, mm-hmm. but readers who are Western and those who are Chinese. Has there been, have you noticed any difference?
I haven't had very much feedback from Chinese readers. I have a friend in Guangzhou who read the book before I submitted it to my publisher, and she said, she said the Chinese character she thought were very authentic, which was a huge relief to me. She said it's my book is full of darkness. Maybe I could show the lighter side of Chinese society and history.
It is fairly dark.
Yeah, but I that's just the way I write. I think all of my books are quite dark, if anywhere, wherever they are. So, yeah.
For me, that's often a reaction that I get from Chinese readers or audience or listeners. By no means everyone, but mm-hmm. certainly a lot of people think, why can't you, you know, without saying why can't you spew propaganda, but why can't you show the more, you know, positive aspects? That's how they would put it.
Right. Why? I mean, I tried to just write as honestly as I could what I was seeing and experiencing. For example, my book has quite a strong pre-Olympics atmosphere because it's set before the Olympics, and the Olympics is very political, and there was a lot of Olympics propaganda and a lot of renovations going on, and I write about the atmosphere of pre-Olympics anticipation, excitement, and how they were beautifying the city. But I think it would have been disingenuous to just show that side of the Olympics and not the other side of heightened security and heightened surveillance. And I mean, in the housing compounds where I lived, the neighborhood committee, they're these retirees, like a neighborhood watch. They oversee the affairs of the community. They put on these armbands that said Olympic security volunteers, and they really tightened, became very hyper-vigilant, and they patrolled the housing compound and monitored comings and goings and knocked on doors and checked passports and residence papers and got some illegal migrant workers kicked out of our compound. And it would have been disingenuous, I think, just to show the sort of the stage managed spectacle of what the Olympic Games was,
which is what everyone saw. During the actual games.
Yeah, and not
the ceremony.
Yeah. Yeah, and not talk about the security as well, and how the Communist Party were very authoritarian in the way they went about things. And there's stories in the news as well about how they were rounding up dissidents and homeless people and the mentally ill and putting them away for the games. It would have been disingenuous not to show that sort of atmosphere of fear and heightened paranoia as well.
Do you have any rituals when you write?
I write first thing in the morning because I don't trust myself to do other stuff in the morning and get to write, and I have to force myself to write first thing. And I usually spend two or three hours writing longhand in the morning with a blank A4 paper and just scribbling all over the paper. And then in the afternoon, I type up the writing. Yeah, that's
so
my
you,
ritual.
You don't write all the way on a
computer.
No,
yeah, it's half and half. And I drink a lot of green tea. I drink about 3 or 4 cups. So I'm very hyper-caffeinated. I believe it's important to drink loads of caffeine when you're writing.
Do you set a number of hours for yourself?
Roughly 6 to 7 hours a day in two chunks, before and after lunch. But When I mean, it sounds like a lot. Before I started writing full time, it was very different. When I was living in Japan and had first started writing, I really would try and write whenever I could, maybe an hour before school or a couple of hours in the evenings in a coffee shop or at lunchtime at school. So I've done both. I've been able to concentrate fully on writing, and I've had a full-time job and tried to fit writing into that as well.
Now, you know, obviously it's so clear that you did so much research firsthand as well as academic. Mm-hmm. How much of you is in the novel? I mean, I don't mean obviously all of you because you wrote it, mm-hmm. but how much of your personal experience, how much of you and how much of it is outside of you, the material that you gathered from outside?
Right. That's quite hard for me to answer because I don't have an objective view of my own writing. I sort of think all of it is outside of me, but perhaps someone would read the book, a family member or a friend of mine, and see echoes of my own character in the book. It's very hard to say.
But they haven't said that yet.
Sorry? They haven't said that. No. With the second book I wrote, it was very clearly there's a lot of parallels between that story and the story of my family. The main character, Frances, she leaves Malaysia in 1969, moves to London, marries an English guy, has two mixed race children. That's very much the story of my own, my mother's trajectory from east to west.
But this one is completely made up.
I think so. there may be parts of me in there. Yeah.
Are you able to tell us what you're working on now?
I'm very creatively drained now after, because I just finished this book in January this year. I've got nothing. I'd like to write nonfiction about China. I'd like to go back to China and try and write nonfiction. Nonfiction's uncharted territory. I haven't had much experience with writing nonfiction. I'd like to sort of branch out and try and do that. We'll see.
Why is that? Is it because it gives you a break from...
Yeah, it will give me a break from having to invent and create. It takes some of the pressure off, I think. Mm-hmm. But then it moves the pressure because people who write journalism and nonfiction, they have to go out in the world and look for stories and that sort of thing. So it'll be different. I won't be drawing water from my own well so much, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. I believe the projects they'll still be generated by me. So, yeah.
You're still living in China, is that right?
I'm not sure. I think I might be going back to the UK for a bit and then back to China and maybe the States. Yeah, so still moving. Yeah.
Great. Well, let's open it up to everyone who has come to join us very early on a Sunday morning. any questions for Susan? Gentleman in the front, would you mind introducing yourself?
Kevin McGeary. I reviewed the novel for a website called The Danfeng. Okay. So you say you threw out the first draft. Mm-hmm. At that point, did you already have the current superstructure in place?
That would be in... When did I throw out that draft?
So a year and a half.
2009-ish. I already had Reincarnation. I already had Anonymous Letters, A Taxi Driver, the historical eras were already in place. Yeah, I had the superstructure in place, but the historical stories were quite weak and flimsy. The main character of The Taxi Driver was weak and flimsy and inauthentic. He was more like a vehicle for my ideas and what I wanted to say about contemporary China. So I had to rewrite him as a real person. So yeah, that's why I threw out that draft. But yes, the superstructure was very much in place. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Lady in the front.
Thank you. Before you started the book, did you believe in reincarnation? And if you didn't, do you believe in it now?
Oh, wow. I don't know. I'm not sure. I mean, I like the idea of reincarnation. Something very strange happened to my sister when we were teenagers. When she was 16 or so, she was at a friend of a friend's house, and the friend of a friend's mother was a medium, and the medium started talking to my sister and saying, your grandmother died recently, and telling my sister things about our grandmother. And she said, oh, and your father is called Trevor, and telling her all this really alarming sort of thing, personal details about her family. And then she said, oh, and you have a sister called Susan, and you actually, you and your sister have had many past lives together, and and you were married in a past life. And my sister came home, and she was 16. She was very scared. She said, yeah, this medium just says that I've been reincarnated and had these past lives. And we sort of laughed at it. But obviously, that stuck in my head when I was writing this book. But I don't think I do believe in reincarnation. I find it frustrating that we just have this one life and it's so short, and I realise that more and more the older I get. And I'd like to think there's something more, some sort of afterlife. But reincarnation, I imagine, would also be quite grim, because it's only the 20th century in certain developed parts of the world that the standard of living has become quite good, and we've moved away from this Hobbesian state of nature. I mean, can you imagine being a reincarnate in medieval times, how horrific that could be? I'm not sure what my answer is. I'm sorry.
Well, you certainly captured a lot of those details of how brutal and Hobbesian the past lives, the past shared lives were. Was that as a result of the research? Or was it your dark, cynical, twisted mind?
Maybe a bit of both, actually. From the research, it did seem as though in all of these different historical eras I write about, life was quite short, and there was no protection of human rights, and your freedom and autonomy can be snatched away from you very easily by a war or a revolution or a peasant uprising or famine. So I do feel in the history of human civilization, it's only been in the past couple of centuries that civilization has become stable and enlightened. It seems as though every historical era I write about, even if you were very wealthy, it was no protection of your human rights. So yeah, a friend interviewed me and he said, the Ming Dynasty was awful. I couldn't read some of that. There's so much gruesomeness and brutality in your story. But I said, well, this is what happened. They did actually punish people by the death by a thousand cuts. That was a state-sanctioned punishment. And there was all these gruesome methods of torturing people that had committed crimes. And it was very, there was no sense of avoiding cruel and unusual punishments in other historical eras.
Did you watch any period drama in the time that you were in China?
I've seen it on TV, but I find it very off-putting because it looks very artificial. Like, you see the wigs and the thick makeup and so I'm aware of it, but I haven't really sat down and watched a whole... I think I've seen some Zhang Yimou films where the costume and the cinematography is a bit better, but I'm not a big fan.
What I thought you got right was that on the whole, Chinese people do culturally believe in reincarnation.
Right.
You know, it's certainly something that people, even communist atheists would say. They would just talk about it in their day-to-day life, much as, they believe in going through the rituals of, serving rice to the ancestors. Mm-hmm. It just seems to be deeply part of the culture.
Right.
Even if you ask them, no, I don't believe in God, but I do believe in reincarnation.
Reincarnation, yeah. Right. I see, yeah.
Next question. Lady in the middle.
Hi, I'm Emily. I'm planning to major in English and history in university, so this has been really interesting for me. But I was just wondering, kind of as a traveler, as a writer, what has your journey of open-mindedness been like, and what have your obstacles been for that part of your writing and traveling?
The journey of open-mindedness. I think going to teach and live in Japan for 2 years was a big part of that journey. It's the first time I'd lived and worked in Asia, and it was the start of my understanding that people are the same everywhere, fundamentally the same. I first started writing fiction set in Japan, all my characters were Japanese, most of the characters. I did write some expat characters as well. But when I first started writing fiction about Japan, I was kind of hesitant. I thought, well, perhaps I can't make this creative leap outside of my own identity and write a Japanese character. It seemed like the wrong sort of thing to do because they're Japanese and very different from me. But then as I wrote more and more and I wanted to write about how the people around me were thinking and feeling. The more I wrote, the more I sort of understood that I can write Japanese characters, and there are surface differences, but I can write authentic characters. I guess I read this book by David Mitchell when I first started writing as well. It's called Number 9 Dream, and it's set in Tokyo, and all of his characters were Japanese as well, and not a world away from how just anyone in the West would think. Again, surface differences, but I guess that gave me courage as well to sort of make that leap outside my own identity.
Well, talking about courage, I'm always so curious, and I always love asking fiction or non-fiction writers, what gives you that courage to face that blank page with something that you created? I'm mainly a broadcaster, mm-hmm. and most people think that the scariest part of my job must be going on television, but actually it's not. The scariest part of my job is facing a blank page,
right.
and writing, you know, writing a couple of thousand words.
Yeah.
So, you know, from your own background, what gave you that confidence to feel that you have something to say that hasn't been said before?
Right.
I guess accepting that perhaps I am saying something that's already been said gave me that confidence, that I didn't have this pressure on me to be brilliant, or like I have writer friends, male writer friends who say, oh, they have this competitiveness when they write. They say, oh, I want to write Ulysses, but better. I never had that. I never had that sort of pressure to be brilliant. And I know that I've come to terms with the fact that the first thing you write is always going to be not the work of art you have in your head. You know, it's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to write badly for a draft and throw it away and start again. So I have that sort of patience, and I don't put too much pressure on myself to create something perfect straight away, and I redraft and redraft. But yeah, I mean, there is a fear of the blank page and starting a project and having the courage and confidence to follow through, and is it all going to fall apart? I mean, while I was writing this book, there were at least 3 or 4 years where I thought, God, this is ridiculous. I'm writing this book about reincarnation. Who's going to take it seriously? Will it get published? Yeah, so there's always this doubt, but you just have to keep writing through it. Yeah.
Lady in the front.
Hi. I totally get what you were saying about needing to live somewhere to be able to research and to absorb it, and then being able to have that come through in your writing. Some writers also experience something that when they leave a country, it's sometimes easier to write about it as well. So, you know, I'm just wondering, for example, you were born in the UK, but you've had so many experiences of living elsewhere. Is there anything that you're ever conscious of that you feel may be drawing you to write about the country of your birth? at some stage?
The UK? I don't know. I'm not sure I feel confident enough to write about the UK, to be honest. I don't know why. It's the UK is a complex and diverse place. I'm not sure I can. I guess I have to research the UK to write about it. I mean, I think I feel comfortable writing about Asia because I'm mixed race. My mother is Malaysian Chinese, and I grew up in this area of East London that it's quite racially mixed. But also, the school I went to was quiet. Most of the people there were Caucasian, and I never really felt like I fit in London. So I felt quite comfortable going off to another country and writing about people there. Maybe one day I'll write about England, write something set in England. Yeah, especially if I end up resettling there. Yeah.
But at the moment, the plan is to write nonfiction in China?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's my provisional plan, yeah.
Why is that? Is that because the research for this novel opened up
I think
new horizons?
China is so vast and diverse, and it's changing all the time. There's so much more to learn about and write about. It just seems there's an infinite amount of things you can write about China. And I still want to continue learning about China and improving my Chinese and traveling around. There's lots of places I haven't traveled to. So there's still, even after having written this book for 6 years, there's still a lot more for me to do in China, I think.
Do you think I'll be able to get a visa for it?
I will see. Yeah.
Next question. The lady in the black and white. If you can introduce yourself and let us know if you've actually, if you've read the book or, have you...
Not yet. I've just bought two to read on holiday next week. I'm very much looking forward to it. Slightly flippant question based on your last answer, Susan. Do you think that potentially Hong Kong would be interesting enough to base a novel here?
I do, actually. I read a bit about... one of the stories I wrote is about the Opium War, and the background to the war is really interesting. The trading relations between Britain and China, and the trading balance of tea for silver, and how they reversed that, the British by importing opium, and then the outlawing of opium, and then the Kowloon incident, which escalated into the Opium War. All of that's really fascinating. And there's a lot I'd like to learn about Hong Kong as well, how it went from just being a bare fishing island to the metropolis it's become. I'd really like to learn more about that story and write about it. Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah, creatively, there's so much energy in Hong Kong and so much to be inspired by. Yeah, for sure. I'd like to write about Hong Kong. Yeah.
Thank you. Gentleman in glasses, yes. Hello.
Hi, my name is Marcus, and I guess I do write some stories when I have the time, but it's not going that well. I guess that comes from partly a lack of motivation, because I'm not looking forward to publish it or anything, and I'm not trying to make a living out of it, so it's really going slowly. So the two questions, it's actually two questions. So the first one is, how do you motivate yourself to write? Like, there's a time of the day, you have a whole day, so what do you do to keep yourself motivated so you go, I have to write this, instead of drifting off to do something else? And the second question is, you mentioned that your experiences in Beijing and Japan has helped with your previous novels that took place there. So what would you say if I were to write about a place that I have never been to? How would you have dealt with that?
Right, okay, so the first question is about motivation. How do I motivate myself to write? I think I have a mild obsessive compulsive disorder. The writing is a manifestation of that. Like, I have to be at my desk by 8 o'clock, otherwise I feel terrible about myself. So yeah, obsessive compulsive disorder, Catholic sense of guilt, coffee, I drink a really strong cup of coffee first thing, and it sort of wakes me up, and I go and start work. I try and set aside a certain number of hours a day, and I'm quite regulated about that because the blank page is scary, as we were saying earlier, and writing's very chaotic, unpredictable. You can't control what you're going to write or the flow of creativity, so it's good to have a sort of structured, regimented time that you force yourself to just go to your desk, and even if it's not working, be there. I'm always very skeptical about people that say they have a very cavalier attitude to writing fiction, like, oh, I'll just write when the inspiration comes or when the muse enters me or whatever. I don't think writing's like that. It's labor, it's hard work, and force yourself to sit at a desk for 2 hours a day, and something will happen. And yeah, that's generally how I motivate myself to write. And also, you know, I don't have any other sort of skill or talent. That's all I know how to do. So it's my lifeblood. And also I enjoy it as well sometimes. The second question, could you remind me of the second question?
So you write about places that, so the places you live in has sort of provided the backbone inspiration for the writings of the character, the backgrounds, the settings, and so on. So what would you say if I were to write about a place that I have never been to and probably never will go to?
Right. I mean, I think that's feasible for you to write good, compelling fiction set in a place you've never been to and have no desire to go to. A friend of mine wrote a novel set in Nigeria, colonial and post-colonial times, did very well, won a prize. He's never been there. He researched like a maniac. It took him maybe 9 years to write this book, but he spent a lot of time in the library reading about Nigeria, colonialism there. So if you do want to do that, I suggest that really research is going to be the backbone of the work of fiction. I think if it's very risky to not really be well prepared. Traveling to the place is one part, and it's not essential. I'm sure it will help, but just research.
I've never written a book, but I've lived with someone who has, mm-hmm. And I remember we set up a second office for him, so not the main office. He was a journalist. We set up a separate office with IKEA desk, with an IKEA desk, and a fairly uncomfortable chair, so he wouldn't fall asleep, or start daydreaming, and we made sure there was no internet. So again,
that's very important.
No,
actually,
not just I'm a bit stuck.
Yeah,
writer's block. Let me go on Google and see what's going on.
It's very important what you say. No internet is really... The internet's a major distraction. I write longhand in the morning, and I have this really old laptop that's falling apart, doesn't connect to wireless, and I use that to write on. It's really helpful.
You mentioned that Shenzhen is a very quiet city culturally. Mm-hmm. Do you think the world could benefit from a book in English about Shenzhen? A non-fiction book about Shenzhen?
There are some. I've read a book called Factory Girls by Leslie T. Chang.
It's Dongguan.
That's Dongguan.
Yeah.
Oh, right, okay. Ah, I see.
But there are parts that overlap.
The Dongguan economy was the fag end of the Shenzhen economy. The factories that Shenzhen didn't want ended up in Dongguan.
I read Beimei. I read a novel called Beimei by Sheng Kei. That's set in Shenzhen as well. Okay. Migrants from Hunan go there and try to make money and make their way. Shenzhen's a really interesting... I mean, as I said, there's not much nightlife or art, visual art or contemporary art going on there. But in terms of what's happening in China, Shenzhen's really fascinating. You know, you have everyone's a migrant in Shenzhen. There's very few Shenzhenren. Everyone's like an yimin. and they all have a different story, and their story is one of struggle and trying to make money and support a family back home. So yeah, definitely. There's a lot there to write about. Yeah.
Yes, lady in the back.
Hi, Susan. I'm Emily, and I've heard that you study philosophy before.
Yeah.
And does it help you to write in fiction or the non-fiction book, do you think?
Yeah, it does. It helps a lot, actually, having studied philosophy. Before studying philosophy, I did a chemistry degree, and in chemistry, you're taught scientific fact. Everything is black and white, true and false. And I remember turning up for one of my first philosophy seminars on the mind and just arguing that everything is materialism, and you know, they tore me apart because that's not how philosophy works. Is you explore different ideas. And I think one way philosophy has really helped is I studied a lot of political philosophy and moral philosophy and moral relativism and how the truth is often very subjective, and that's helped a lot with writing fiction. I often in my stories have many different characters, and the sense that the truth is a multiplicity of viewpoints. Everyone has their own subjective truth, and a morality is very much a grey area, whether or not what a character's doing is wrong or right. And it sort of taught me to withhold moral judgments from the characters I create, and my characters, as a result, they're quite... I mean, they do a lot of things that may be considered immoral, but I recognise that's very human and we are flawed, and it's okay to dwell in this sort of grey area of moral and immoral actions. Does that make sense? Yeah?
And that's what often gives narrative conflict, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that's good.
Yeah. The fact that yeah, people, they contain multitudes. They can be good sides to someone, self-interest, and their people's self-interest clashes with someone else's self-interest and objectives, and that causes conflict, which creates a narrative.
Any questions?
Hi, Susan. I was just wondering that when you were writing the book, do you have a target audience? Like, you want the book to be like a story to tell the Westerner about a little bit about China, or for like the readers in Beijing to read the book?
I don't really have a target audience. Someone asked me this question in Beijing, actually, have I written this book to teach Westerners about China? I don't think the book has that sort of didactic ambition. I wanted to write a book about China, but not to explain China to the West or to any specific audience. I wanted to write about China to learn about China myself, and just I don't know. When you're interested in something, you have the impulse to make art about it. So that was my motivation, primarily. And I guess I do convey some political messages in the book, unique, specific to China. But I also convey messages about the history of human civilization and human nature. And those were the most important messages. But I don't see a book as being a vehicle for the author's opinion. What must come first is the characters and the plots, and then the themes arise from that. That's okay. Does that answer your question, actually?
Did the characters ever speak to you over the writing process? Maybe not the first year and a half, but... certainly after that.
Do you mean like I hear the characters' voices?
Yeah.
I don't know if they speak to me, but with each redrafting, I understand them more and more. I understand their psychology. I understand how they'll behave in any situation I put them in. I hear when I'm writing, I hear their voices and the tone they use and understand better the way they think. But yeah, I read this interview of Siri Hustvedt, and she's this Norwegian writer, and she said before she fell asleep at night, she would hear her characters having conversations with each other in her head. Sounds a bit schizophrenic, but I mean, I don't have that kind of, my characters aren't that real to me, but definitely while in the act of writing, while I'm writing, I hear them speak in the story. Yeah.
Any questions from before?
I thought I saw a few hands, but I didn't acknowledge them, so sorry.
Hi, Susan. I'm Sue. I'm Malaysian, and you know, I lived through the 1969 riots. So you know, your story is very compelling about your mum making her way to England. I think there was huge exodus of people who left the country at that time. Do you sort of get support from your family, you know, in your choice of becoming a writer? Because a lot of people think it's a hard life and you should go get a proper job, you know, teach English or something like that. I mean, you know, a lot of young people in Hong Kong, I teach in a university, they, you know, they say the parents put a lot of pressure on them not to choose, not to make writing as a choice of profession, that they should get a real job, you know, like in a bank or something.
Right.
So what sort of advice would you give to young people who are creative, who wants, you know, to take that path of, you know, wanting to be a writer,
right.
And is family support very important? And also, finally, my question is, you know, so what's happened to Malaysia with the recent, you know, planes? Two of them, you know, one disappears, right, and another one gets shot down. It's like, it's crazy, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you know, with the plane that disappeared, a friend of mine said, well, somebody should write about the fourth dimension. And I thought, you know, since you write about incarnations, maybe that could be, you know, the scene for your next story. Thank you.
Your first question, my parents, amazingly, because my mother, she is a stereotypically strict, authoritarian, first generation Asian mother. But the thing is, my family in Malaysia, they were quite poor. When my mother was growing up, she had 9 brothers and sisters. They grew up in absolute poverty from the sounds of it, and became wealthier as my mother was in her late teens and then moved to the UK to become a nurse. So there wasn't a huge, you know, there wasn't a huge amount of pressure to become a doctor or a lawyer in my mother's generation. And my mother was quite, she was very strict and authoritarian in some ways. Like, she didn't like me to go out late at night, but she never really pressured me academically. So I had a lot of freedom in that sense. My father did a bit. He encouraged me very strongly to go into science, but when I said science is not working for me, I want to move to philosophy, he was fine with it, and I did. And so yeah, that gave me a lot of freedom, actually, the fact that they let me choose what to study. And when I became a writer, when I studied for an MA in creative writing, again, they weren't overly impressed, but they weren't resistant either, and they let me go ahead and do that. And I paid for the MA myself. I'd saved money in Japan, and I just took myself to Manchester and started studying. I was incredibly lucky in the fact that I got a literary agent and sold the book right at the end of the course. So, and then I had money to live off. So they just left me. They're like, okay, so you're writing now. This is your career. I think it may have been a different story if I, it had taken me a few years to write my first book, and I was just doing, because a lot of writers I know, they work part-time. They work in libraries, or they work teaching creative writing for low pay. Perhaps they'd have a different attitude, but or maybe not. I think actually they'd be okay with that as well. So yeah, I had a huge amount of freedom, and I've been very lucky. There's been no pressure on me to to be an accountant or a, all my cousins in Malaysia, they're a bit younger than me because my mother's the oldest daughter. They're all accountants and they work in IT and they have good jobs and they're slightly baffled why I write, but that's fine. Did you ask me what would I say to someone who wanted to go into a career in writing? Wow, I mean, it's really hard because the publishing climate has changed in the last decade a lot. It's changed in the decade since I first sold my book. Publishers are less inclined now to take risks on new writers' debut novels and give advances. The average advance is really small. It's less than £5,000, £3,000. It's very hard to live off that kind of money. And to write full time. I mean, I think to write a book to the best of your ability, you have to work part time or not work at all and just be really frugal so you can focus. So I would say to anyone who wants to be a writer, do you really love writing? Do you love it more than job security and pension plans and mortgages? Is that the most important thing for you? Do you love literature? If it is, then go for it. I wish you the best of luck. That's what I would say. And be prepared to work hard because it is quite hard work. It has this image of being quite romantic, but it's not at all. It's graft. So it's a very pessimistic sort of message, but for me it wasn't a choice. I can't not write fiction, so it's what I did, and I don't mind not having money. I didn't mind not having money while I was writing this book. And the last question was about Malaysia.
The planes.
Yeah, I really don't feel qualified to comment. I'm like everyone else here, just reading the different accounts in the news and feeling really confused. I don't know what's going on at all, I'm afraid. It's terrible though. Yeah.
Well, as someone who's actually covered the first airliner, I can't say we know more.
Yeah.
And some people have theories about, you know, that it simply disappeared or was taken by aliens, and sometimes you think, maybe, because we don't know where it is. Yeah. We really don't know. Yeah. We're not any closer to knowing where it is.
Are you reporting on the second?
No. That story is much more in Europe.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I'm here. Hurrah! Great. I think we have time for perhaps one more question, if there are any more.
Anyone who's going to ask?
Okay.
Hi, Susan. So thank you for giving us an introduction of your book and your experience as a writer. I'm just curious, since you have done a lot of research about the Chinese history in your latest novel, so which of those historical periods appeal to you the most, and how do you see the Chinese culture has changed or evolved from the past to contemporary times?
Wow. My favorite historical story, the era, is the Tang Dynasty, because the Tang Dynasty was such a... It's known as Golden Age in Chinese history, but it was such a comparatively liberal and open time in China. China was my story set in Chang'an, which is medieval Xi'an, and it was a very cosmopolitan city. It was at the end of the Silk Route, so you had travelers and merchants coming from Central Asia and Europe and beyond. It was just a very lively time. Aesthetically, it's very attractive as well. There's great Tang Dynasty poets like Li Bai and Du Fu, and lots of great visual art. So to me, Tang Dynasty China is the most appealing age in Chinese history. And it was comparatively forward thinking. I think China became more closed in later dynasties and sort of hostile to the rest of the world, but it was quite open and flourishing during the Tang Dynasty, 7th to 9th century. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. I think that's all the time that we have this morning. Thank you so much, Susan Barker, for joining us.